when we think about crisis communication, one of the critical components is that we don't come to messaging until quite late in the game, because in order to select the right messages, in order to build the most effective campaign possible in terms of how we respond, how we engage with different stakeholders, we need to know what's going on with the situation, and we certainly need to understand what's going on with our critical stakeholders and everything else before we get too wrapped up in terms of the particulars of the crisis response. And I think that we can probably look to current events. You know, the U.S. is a great example, especially with Donald Trump in his waning days in the White House, happily. But we can look to gut reaction as generally being less effective in terms of responding to situations than careful, planned response. Of course, there are going to be situational dynamics that mean that the best laid plans have to be revised. But we come to crisis response messages very late in the semester for a purpose. Because if organizations and if crisis responders don't understand the dynamics of the situation and they don't understand the crisis and the stakeholders involved, it doesn't make for a very effective response. So if you guys didn't read it closely, I would encourage you to go back to chapter 2 in your text and the reflection from Ben Duncan, who works for the World Health Organization, on lessons learned from the Ebola crisis in Africa. And one of the critical lessons learned that he talks about is that when you don't understand the stakeholders, you can get the message wrong and it can cost lives. So one of the things that the World Health Organization has learned is about making sure that the crisis response is very much attuned to the local sensibilities. You know, one of the problems in that particular situation, as Ben talks about it, was a lack of trust about government and things that are official. What they genuinely in their communities were worried about was that if someone came forward with Ebola, that they were just going to get taken away and never seen again. Now, if you guys think about the crisis reporting amongst college students with the pandemic, most students are underreporting corona symptoms, whether they've tested positive, for a couple of different reasons. One is that the early on, with especially what, like in Manchester and Glasgow, where students were basically caged in their student housing, they found out that their housemates weren't very happy if they caused them to be quarantined and not to be able to be let out. So there's a social desirability component to that. The other bit is the worry about negative consequences if they report to the university or to the local health authorities. So what we're finding in COVID is very much the same as what we found, what Ben talked about in terms of Ebola in Africa, is a lack of institutional trust or social desirability. There are compounding factors that in the case of disease and pandemic are actually inhibiting people from being open and honest about their reporting. If you look at track and trace in England, part of the difficulty, I mean, let's set aside the incompetence of the structural setup of the system, but part of the problem too in England is a lack of trust in the government to use the information effectively. So this doesn't bode particularly well when you're trying to manage information. So from a communication stance, the critical challenge would then be trying to address that problem before you can get into the substance of persuading people about track and trace. Now, as we're moving forward, since there seems to be hope on the vaccination, the next critical stepping stone is going to be to persuade the public to take the vaccination. Now, I think generally speaking, most people are aware that the average time, about a long average time, but the average time to get a vaccination from the development process to market is about 10 years. We're talking 7 months. The communication gap that responders and government officials, members of any kind of health-related organization are trying to figure out is how to create confidence in the safety of the vaccine. Not because people are anti-vaccination. This week, there has been some problematic coverage of the anti-vax movement and trying to blame Facebook and other social media platforms on this rampant distrust in vaccinations, and especially in looking ahead to the COVID-19 vaccination. The problem is that it's misdiagnosing it. They're coming from a gut reaction and not actually a well-informed position. So what they will probably do is make a communication mistake in terms of the strategy used. So by kicking at Facebook or any other social media platform about disinformation with the anti-vaccination movement, which is a challenge, they're picking the wrong fight. They have to promote confidence. So if anyone watched Dr. Van Tam's press conference about the vaccination, he did the mum test. Would he have his mom vaccinated with the COVID-19 vaccine? And he said yes. That is a smart response because it's trying to show, because the question is, you know, and this comes around anytime government officials do things that could be risky. Like, would you send your child to war? The posh tend not to send their children to war these days. That tends to be, you know, send the working class to war. The same is true when we're talking about risk, and that's how people think about it, especially when you have situations where there's a lack of trust in institutions. So that mum test, and then if I were the communications person for this government, which for this government I would never be, but if I were the communication person for this government, I would have very clear, you know, it would be every single member of the cabinet getting the vaccination, their parents getting the vaccination, anyone, you know, healthcare workers, have it all filmed. Because that's the only way that you're going to start to inspire confidence. The other thing is, quite honestly, there will be a portion of people who will want it now. There are, however, a good portion of folks who probably will want to wait 6 months to see how it goes. And this is actually, we can see this with technology uptake too. You have early adopters, you have medium adopters, and you have late adopters. So anytime you have innovation that occurs, you can act, this is a pretty predictable pattern. So you embrace the early adopters because they're the ones who will help you make the case. They're the ones who will say, hey, I've been vaccinated and I am getting on with my life and things have gone well. I've had few meaningful side effects, blah, 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 blah. They're helpful and necessary in getting the medium adopters, the ones who have the wait and see, let's see if this actually works. Let's see if there aren't any side effects about it. And I'll be honest, I'm probably in that middle adopter. I'm that way with technology, and I'm certainly that way with this vaccine. But it's not because I have any anti-vaccination attitude. It's simply because I want to see. But this then helps with the late adopters, the people who are more hesitant. So this is part of the reason when we think about message development and creation, this is where we see all of this kind of fitting together. And that's why we come at it relatively late. If you understand the relationship between the organization, i.e. in this case, the government, and the stakeholders, the public, if you understand their relationship to the issue, so in this case, COVID, you know, most people want to get their lives back to some sort of normality. But the question is where they see the most risk. So if you can understand risk adoption and the ways that people respond to risk, you're going to be much more likely to understand how to tap into the messages and what messages are likely going to be to inspire confidence. Largely, this will be about confidence. That's not the case with all crisis response. But in terms of helping people to adopt behaviors to reduce their risk, that's typically one of the most common needs. So all of this diagnosis, and then the final element is the relationship between the government and the issue. So part of what hurts the UK government is that we've watched them botch it for months. We've watched bad decision after bad decision. We've watched money get wasted on things that have been ineffective. That affects how we see their credibility. And so when they're saying, take this vaccination, it's brilliant, that's also going to be part of the hesitancy for people. So without kind of connecting all of those dots, we don't have the way to really target the messages. So having Van Tam is a smart move, because he is probably the one who's seen as the less establishment kind of guy. He's the one who has been a bit critical, but also been quite sciencey in the way that he's done it, whereas Whitby and a couple of the others have largely just deferred to the government. He hasn't. So he's actually a good salesman for this particular set of messaging. So it's all about layering on, and the more that we understand the dynamics of those relationships, the better we can choose our particular messaging strategy. So, you know, in thinking about in terms of current events, that's where I want you to think as you guys are making your crisis plans. You don't have to think about it in terms of COVID. That's just the exemplar. But think about all of those relationships as you're thinking about the message strategy. So what I want to do as we get into this is I want to take a look at the requirements for your paper, for your final project. Then we're going to break out into discussion groups, and they won't necessarily be your teams, but break out into discussion groups where you will talk about one of the cases that we've talked about this week. So it'll be the whistleblowing, the ethical apology, or it'll be the lipstick on the pig, the CSR one. And I want you to really focus on the conclusions and the connection between theory and practical application. And then we'll come back together and discuss those at the end. So you'll discuss those in your breakout groups as a group, kind of come to a set of conclusions. And then your final really assignment for your small individual assignments, which will be due next Monday, is for each of you individually, and I'll show you where all of the full description is, but for each of you individually to write a very short critical reflection on one of those cases. You can choose the one that you discussed today. You're just going to be tossed into a group at random. So if that's not the one that you're really interested in, that's fine. But you'll choose one of the cases and you'll write about it. So I'll show you where all that stuff is. So let's take a quick tour to the team report information. So this is, of course, under the, if you go to the team report information, and I have this zoomed in so you can actually see it, but under assessment and feedback, and then team report information, then scroll down to the bottom. There are a few things that I want to point out. First, it is due the 11th of December at midnight. That's the Friday. It's the last gasp before you guys are released into the world for the holidays. And everything should be in a single document. Now, there are, starting up here, the general guidelines for it mostly focus on writing recommendations. And it is to give you an idea about the things in the writing process that I think are important. So the first bit about this is the length. They need to be between 3,500 and 4,000 words. Now, for the most part, you have four-ish people in your group, and this was designed so that no single person was going to be doing more than about 1,000 words worth of writing. So I really want to make sure that it is tight and concise, because quite frankly, the crisis plan for an organization is meant to be the game, the playbook for the crisis. So you're writing for an executive decision maker. These aren't people who want to read long treatises. Now, the word length in and of itself does not include any tables, any figures, your references, or your appendices. It's just the core content of the writing itself. So it's meant to be nice and tight. It's also meant to be quite visual. Chapter 16 in your text goes through each of the steps bit by bit. So it is, though, a research-based project. All the arguments, all the conclusions that you offer need to be really well-grounded. And the guidance is that I give you, and that is basically that I'm looking for 10 to 15 academic quality sources. So that means peer-reviewed journal articles or chapters in edited books. You can also use your module textbooks as sources. And then there also needs to be 10 to 15 other sources. And these can include news, organizational resources, industry publications. They can also include additional academic sources. But this is a minimum level of source expectation. It's not a scoreboard. Just because you may have hit 10 to 15 does not necessarily mean that the rest of the paper doesn't need to have any. When you're making assertions, you need to make sure that you have support for them. And the support needs to be appropriate to the assertion. So, as far as the citation of the sources in text, I am quite happy for you to use footnotes, because that's what you would use in a professional report most of the time. Or you can use just traditional Harvard referencing, that's up to you. But the reference section itself needs to be in Harvard style. And along those lines, you can choose to write this as either formatted as an academic essay, or you can make it as a polished looking professional report. That's entirely up to you, but it needs to be consistent in that. So the other thing to say kind of generally about the report is that this is an argumentative essay. You are making specific recommendations to your organization, so it needs to be argumentative. You can't just describe. You don't have the luxury of 10, 12,000 words where you can go into deep description. You need to make sure that you come to points very quickly, you offer support, and that it's clear. You know, think about how to make a compelling, sometimes visual kind of argument, and to lay information out so that it's information at a glance. A few bits of writing. Please take note of this when you guys are proofreading, especially. It's not so much in the initial drafting, but it's when you're proofreading. Never use contractions. Never use second person voice, especially in a professional report. You and your is never appropriate. Avoid passive voice because it weakens your argument, and also avoid excessive quotation. Not only does it take away from the flow of your writing, but when you have limited space and a lot to do within that space, it takes away from the flow. Short, concise quotations can be sprinkled in, but typically you want to be paraphrasing. Align your text left and not fully justified. Fully justified is terrible to read. It may look pretty if you are looking at it from 10 feet back because all the margins are even, but it's terrible to read because of the inconsistent spacing between the letters and the words. So make sure it's all left justified. If you use indents, then all the lines can have the same spacing, But if you use block paragraphs, like where you don't indent, make sure you put extra space in between. Then the other thing, and this is what is often very funny with papers that you read, is reference padding. There needs to be a one-to-one relationship between the references cited in your actual piece and the references in the reference section. A lot of times, people will just put everything they ever read about it in their reference section without citing it appropriately in text. So you need to make sure that the only sources you include in your reference section are meaningfully integrated within the paper itself. And the other bit is that basically, as you're going through this, refer to chapter 16 of your text for details, for information, and guidance on writing the crisis plan. You know, there are a lot of correct ways, and don't think that everything needs to be in there. You're making and tailoring a crisis plan to your organization to a particular crisis context. So you need to make good judgments in how you write it. And a lot will depend on the content and on the group's approach. But so what I would recommend that you do is think about these big sections. So what I expect from everybody's piece is that you have an executive summary, and this should be something that's no longer than 500 words, but it gives the quick summary of the entire thing at a glance, including the critical action steps. You need to also have a rationale for building the crisis plan itself. Those are typically around 500 to 750 words, and they give a big picture connection between issues in crisis management and it's the importance in the organization or even the industry that you guys are writing about. It also provides the key summary of the argument that you're going to make throughout. Then what you'll do, and this is where you guys will be able to see all the work that you've been doing in terms of the stakeholder map coming together, the initial PESTEL analysis into the stakeholder map, into the risk registers, which I know I've been a bit slower than I had planned on getting those back, but I'm going to work on getting those back to you this week. All of those coming together into the risk summary. Now, what you guys are doing is creating a crisis plan for one type of crisis. So you will pick transgressions, events, disasters, or reputational crisis. Only one of those broad categories. So there can be a lot of examples of those types of crises within your organization and that could affect your organization, but you're selecting the type. You would never create a crisis plan for every single crisis that the organization could face. That's just not time sensible. But if you do it by crisis type, what we've found in the research is that consistently the type of the crisis influences, like we've been talking about, the severity and the risk to the organization as well as to the stakeholders. And that's a critical aspect in terms of determining the responses that are going to be appropriate, aside from the stakeholder dispositions to both the organization and the issue. But it's the type that ends up affecting all of that a lot more than almost any single other thing. So that's why we would always write to crisis types and not necessarily particular crises, unless you're in an industry. You know, so for example, if you're in the oil and gas industry, having a deep water crisis, a deep water break in your well, that's going to be a very specific kind of crisis that you might pick out. But for the most part, if you have the plan that's about the type of crisis, it ends up being much more effective. I'm not going to have you guys write a separate crisis plan for all four different types of crisis, because quite frankly, it's a bit repetitive and it doesn't really enhance what you're getting from the learning process. It just gets a bit repetitive. So I'm wanting you to focus on just a single type of crisis. And that's part of the rationale. you're making an argument about the type of crisis and why that one should get attention. So you go through the risk summary, then you'll go through the contingency planning and the 8 parts of that, and then you build your conclusion, which is a reminder of the key lessons learned and the key strategies. Now, you will have and create message samples. Those will go into the appendix, so they're not included. But so as you go through, walk through each of those parts, you'll need to think about how you're presenting the information. Most of it is quite simple and straightforward, because if you've connected your risk summary, then things like the trigger points or the situational assessment become more of a summary reminder of what you've already covered from the risk summary and how then that gets translated beyond it. So are there any general questions about the crisis plan itself before we move forward?
Survey question about the thing on the 4th of December, is that going to be done in class or
yes, the simulation is not on the 4th, is it? Hold on, let me double check.
The simulation is the 30th, isn't it?
Yes, yeah, so no, the 30th, the 4th of December will be a bit of a feedback. Yeah, that'll be a bit of a feedback. And it'll be an opportunity for you guys to ask questions about your projects. So I would recommend everyone join us for class. But no, if everything's squared away, then you can just kind of carry on, use that as a work session, work day. But typically I've found that those are useful. The assignment itself that's due, the simulation reflection, that is just an individual assessment. So we'll talk more about that next week, because it is it's more relevant to the simulation itself. But that's an individual assignment that you just sort of add on yourself. It's a quick, not research based, but reflection on the experience you had from the 30th when we do this simulation. And I'll talk about the simulation more next week. But that is, it'll be the full day. It'll be about 10 to 4, 10 to 5 o'clock. So make sure that you're kind of ready for the whole day. And this is something that we had timetabled and they know about. But you guys will be experiencing a crisis as it unfolds. And so it is a bit of an intense day, and things will happen as you go along. We normally would do these over in the simulation suite, and I bring snacks, but alas, you guys will have to provide your own snacks. But so good question. Yeah, no, that is, you gave me a bit of a heart attack there for a minute. But no, that is just an individual assignment. But on the 4th, and let me take a quick peek at the dates here. On the 4th, that's the Friday. So on the 7th of December, we won't have class itself, but I will be here during our session if you have any questions about your projects, anything like that. So from next week, which is the 23rd, we wrap up the course content, the module content. You'll have your simulation, which will get folded into the experience of the crisis that you have, hopefully will be informative. This will be the subtle suggestion, but that should be informative in terms of the finalization of your crisis plan. But most of the work on your crisis plan, you can actually start moving forward from next week. On the essay itself, it's not something that I want you guys to stress over. It's meant to be something short, concise, that summarizes the work that you've been doing and adds in. You will have been doing the research, and quite frankly, let me shift to it real quick, but one of the recommendations that I would have is actually, if you guys look over here, and let me zoom out on that a little bit. Oops. Transfer. Zoom. So on this side, under the resources, the module books is just the textbooks itself, but under the supplemental readings, one of the recommendations that I have is that don't spend a lot of time doing library-based research. I have recommendations for reading. So, for example, under stakeholder relationship management, I have recommendations for reading under each of these, and most of them are linked. So, most of the articles are linked in there. So, my recommendation is to start here for your academic research, and for the most part, you probably shouldn't have to go beyond it. So I'm not expecting you to go do a bunch of library research on this. Use the information that you actually have in this section. And you'll also notice that on your PowerPoint slides each week, there are references, and those references are largely reflected in the recommended readings for each week as well. So that's where I would say that most of your research should probably come from for those 10 to 15 journal articles. The crisis plan itself is much more of an analytic endeavor. So one of the reasons that I've had you guys do both individually and as groups these reflection exercises is because it's the skill set to develop in reflecting on an experience and then projecting that to future possibilities is very much about how it is that you connect experience, practice, and the topics that we're talking about. That's one of the thing critical elements that I'm looking for in a good crisis plan, and that really is part of this process of developing very good crisis plans and good practice. So it doesn't even matter, if you never have anything to do with crises again, which is highly unlikely in your lives, but if you never have anything to do with crisis again, the transferable skill set in terms of taking information from the situation and making strategic recommendations on it, I think applies to management, marketing, public relations, journalism, most of the things to do with decision making in organizations and sort of the pragmatics of all of that. So that's why we've been doing those kind of reflective exercises as well. Other questions? Like I said, chapter 16 in your text, when you guys are working on your group in your groups for the assignment, make sure that you're really focusing on and engaging with each of those and elements. And I have example tables. That's not how you have to do it. It's just a suggestion. And the other thing about this is that when you're putting all these kind of recommendations together, like in the textbook, you're trying to be as inclusive as possible. Not everything will be relevant to your organization or to the particular crisis. So you guys need to make sure that you're making strategic decisions about the way that you present the information and the recommendations about the crisis and about the crisis type and making the arguments. So what we're going to do now, if you don't have any other questions, and like I said, I'm quite happy on both on this. We'll be on the 7th of December. We won't have class formally, but these 2 hours I'll set aside and have the collaborate site open so that you guys can come in. No, Olivia, we will not have a quiz due next week, and I'll post the announcement for that. So no quiz next week. I think you guys have done a good job with everything. So like I said, the materials for next week are very much about the application in a crisis plan. So that will be a t that's the test is as you guys pull together your crisis plans as to how you do that. So what we'll do now is it's 10:40 now. I will give you about a half an hour. So let's see, the risk register. The risk register, I will probably have Dan. Well, I will have that this week so that you have feedback on it. I just got a little bit behind where I wanted to be with on doing that. But you'll get that, and then the crisis capacity this or next week. But you'll have both of those sets of marks before you get too heavy into it. But especially the feedback on the risk register you will have. Any other questions? Right, so it is about 10:40. What we're going to do is you're going to be randomly assigned into the breakout groups. Don't worry about which group you're in. And it's to discuss, you'll see which one that you're getting assigned to. Take about a half an hour to discuss that case. You can refer to the lecture, you can refer to the article on it. But what I want you to focus on as a group in your discussion are a couple of things. First, what are the critical lessons learned from the situation? So towards the end of the article or towards the end of the lecture is where those critical lessons learned are. How are those applicable beyond that situation? That's the first question that I want you to ask is, how are those lessons learned, or to what degree can they be applicable beyond that situation? The second question will be, how does theory help the application, or to what extent does theory help the application? And let me type those in.